Good afternoon. Our last session today before we break for lunch. Our next speaker, Janakiraman Jayachandran, who is the practice head, SaaS and Cloud Practice Management at Asper Systems. As a practice manager at Asper Systems, Janaki is instrumental in defining the company's focus in SaaS and cloud computing. He is involved in cloud consulting and customers to guide them towards defining their cloud strategy and has successfully helped several ISVs and enterprise to move towards cloud. He also collaborates with Aspire SaaS Center of Excellence towards building internal expertise on various cloud technologies. Having worked with several customers on their cloud needs, he has expertise in both enterprise and consumer-based SaaS application. He is a regular speaker at various SaaS and cloud events. And without taking much time, I'd request Janaki to start a session.
Hi, everyone. This session, I'm not going to bore you with the more of cloud-related information because I'm sure you must have heard and read a lot about cloud and the various benefits the cloud is bringing to you. But then where things are not unclear to enterprises is there are lots and lots of options available today when it comes to the cloud, cloud services, and the taxonomy of cloud itself has been expanding in a rapid pace. And there are so many services that are getting added every day. So as an enterprise, if I'm interested in cloud, where do I start with, right? So how do I go about moving it? There are so many things that I keep hearing. There is SaaS, public cloud, private cloud, VDI, right? So we are going to take a look at how one can kind of objectively move across and think about the various needs an enterprise might have and then use that to form their cloud strategy. So basically starting with the why I should go to the cloud, right? Rather than trying to see the implementation level details, we'll start to look at the need of it and then we'll move to the actual details, right? So broadly speaking, something should drive you towards the cloud, right? It's not just because cloud has been used by everybody, you have to use it. But then what is that from your perspective, from your organization that is driving it, right? So broadly speaking, there are two driving factors. One purely from an infrastructure management and the other one is from an application management. Many a times people try to confuse these two things and they try to interview these two things and try to have a solution in one shot, right? So let's try to understand in detail what this constitutes of. The first one, the infrastructure management, as you could see the typical pain points, what are you trying to tackle here, right? As an enterprise, one is of course your cost, the capex constraints you may have. Well, you know that there is going to be a lot of infrastructure need coming up down the line, but then you are also constrained with the budgets. That way you cannot just go out and buy so much of servers, right? So that's going to be your typical pain point. And of course your data center capacity, today what you have may not be sufficient down the line. So the whole focus of this area, this scenario is IT, right? So IT is your primary focus. And what are the various avenues for me under this infrastructure management? The typical areas where I could probably be making use of cloud. So broadly speaking, compute, storage, two broad areas within this. Compute is, like we have seen, you have the ability of scaling up, ramping up, up and down, supporting diversified technology stacks, Java, .NET and so on, right? Availability, replication, standard things. Storage wise, there are like this disaster recovery support, you can have your archives, the storage of it, static content, CDN, right? So as a company, the first thing is to look at, are these things that I want to be moving to cloud? Are these things that makes sense for me to move to a cloud? Are these cloud candidates in the first place? So pick and choose the things that would be of interest to you, right? I'll skip this slide. And particularly, this is one interesting slide where it will help you to further kind of understand what kind of a workload patterns you might be experiencing. So these are some of the workload patterns typically involved in any enterprise. One is your rapid growth. Of course, the first one, the on and off period. So there could be certain period or season in time where you might have to use those capacity, and certain periods of time it's going to be a lull, right? It's going to be idle. Or it could be a very fast ramp up scenario or a burst scenario, both a predictable and unpredictable burst. So you have to handle all of these scenarios. So scalability, these are some of the scenarios you will have to think about. storage wise we saw this. Now coming to the application management side of it, now this is a totally a different perspective of viewing. So first one, what we saw is from an IT perspective, right? So we saw the different areas that are possible or potential areas for moving to a cloud. But from an application management perspective, some of the pain points enterprises that face today are, one is the pace of development itself, and also the need to be able to dynamically adapt to the changes that is happening in the business, right? So these are the two typical pain points. If you see, you want things to be done as fast as it can be, right? At the same time, be able to be flexible to changes and get it done quickly. So some of the common scenarios that could be applicable under the application management side, right? So your one could be a development platform itself. Now, development platform plays a very vital role when you want to bring standardization, right? So there are typical cases where enterprises have like 200 applications built on different technologies, built on different architectures and so on. But then slowly people are moving into the standardization there, right? Which is basically having one platform which could provide the base of it and then have applications built as silos on top of the platform. Platform BPO is one such kind of a concept, right? So if you are aiming towards moving to a platform-based approach, then development platform could be one of the avenues that could be leveraged from a cloud perspective. The other things are much straightforward, central availability, or if you are in the process of migrating your application or a technology upgradation, right? The interesting things are, for example, this one, the enable citizen developers. This could be another area of interest where there is, this term has been coined by Gartner, in a citizen developer, which represents providing capability to a normal end user to be able to put together a solution by themselves. So you may have a sales manager who might want to probably put together a small CRM kind of a system, or it could be other departments in the enterprise which may want to probably create small systems, small applications. So right now they have to depend the IT. They have to raise that request, put down the requirements, convey it, and then it has to go back, development, design, testing, right? So enabling citizen developers is where you give them a framework which could be used just like in power user, where people can build their applications by themselves without any need of an IT support, right? So it's pretty much doing it by themselves. They can build it, deploy it, start using it, right? As simple as that. So those are some of the areas where the scenarios could lead to you looking for a cloud. And this is the broader picture of the whole cloud itself. So having seen the different areas where you could probably be identifying, right? The next step is to look at how these different compositions help towards implementing the enterprise cloud that I'm desiring to have. So one is the deployment models itself, right? Which is where your public, private, community cloud and hybrid comes into picture. But there is also few other things that comes into picture, which is your application based service, which we'll delve into it a bit detail, but there is a set of application service models, right? And then a set of utility service models as well. And these three together netted across, there is also another aspect of the service characteristics, which we even saw in the previous session. And all these together combined is what is going to result you for your enterprise cloud. So quickly looking at what each one of this mean, the public cloud, I think you pretty much are aware. So basically, a cloud provider provides you a set of machines. So as a user, you get in, access it, and then once you're done, you get out of it, right? And you are going to have your own boundaries to be able to control it. Private cloud, on the other hand, when we say private cloud, people generally get confused. Okay, so what is that? What do I call? I have in my own facility here. What do I call that? Is it a private cloud? So there are two types of private cloud. One, an on-site private cloud, which is where the enterprises can have their own existing infrastructure and use that existing infrastructure to convert it into a private cloud. And of course, private cloud, the very meaning of it, is only owned and used by the single enterprise. The biggest advantage here is, of course, you are able to reuse your existing infrastructure, right? That's the biggest advantage you get out of it. Because you already invested in it, why do you want to waste it? On top of it, you get the benefit of having the full control, implementing the policies becomes much easier. Another scenario where you go for an outsourced private cloud. This is where your third-party cloud providers come into picture. So the same concept, except that they provide you a dedicated environment out of the whole grid that they have, and there is a perimeter drawn around it, which means only that particular organization will be able to access it. Now this will not be able to be giving all the flexibility that you are available here, but then from a cost perspective, of course, this is better. Community cloud, this is still in early stages compared to the public and private cloud, because there aren't too many communities at this time. But the working model of it is simple. There are two models into it. One is the on-site community cloud, where every organization can pool their resources, and together they constitute as one single resource and could be accessed across all the organizations. Right? That's one model in which it could work. The other model, again, the outsourced community cloud, the same concept as private cloud, except that this perimeter is now given access to a set of organizations belong to the same community. Hybrid cloud is very simple. So depending on your different needs, you might probably adopt multiple strategies, and hence you may end up having your probably critical and confidential kind of applications on your private cloud, have the secondary non-critical on public cloud, and so on. So you can define your own combination how you want it. So that brings us to the application service model. So we saw the deployment models itself. So that is one aspect to determine, right, whether what should I go for, a public, private, or so on. But once I decide that, within the application service models, from an application development and management perspective, what kind of options do I have? So to put it in very simple terms, in a typical on-premise application, you have these boxes, right, these different layers. And if it is on-premise, of course, you are responsible to manage the whole thing. IaaS is something which will take off some of the burden out of you, which is probably till the virtualization layers, it takes care of. So your Amazon or any other IaaS providers provide you the virtualized environment, and further on, it's your job, right, from the OS to upgrading the OS patches, the security patches. It's like your responsibility to ensure that is in sync, right? So you manage those boxes. And then your platform as service goes one step ahead, where you have the runtime also available as part of the platform as a service. And all you need to do manage is the application and data that is coming out of the PaaS. And SaaS is where the whole thing is managed by the vendor, and you are just subscribing and using it, which means there's absolutely nothing that you own here, except for, of course, the data that you are going to be feeding it into the system, right? So further drill down of this, the question to ask when it comes to this particular model is, how much of it do I want to own, right? And the answer of it could vary depending on the enterprise, depending on the policies you have, depending on the applications you have. So a quick summary of how you can probably decide it more objectively. So as we saw, the IaaS getting into more finer level of detail, you could, so you could have control up to this particular layer, right? So as a subscriber, you could have access to your application, any middleware and the OS, that's what we saw. Whereas on these two aspects, you absolutely don't have any control on the hardware, right? And when it comes to the platform as a service, you don't have any control on the OS or hardware, totally all ruled out. On the software as a service, of course, the application is what you have access to. And what this means is, in case if you have a need to build an application, you will be evaluating one of these three options, right? So which means when it comes to a SaaS, it's pretty much a make or buy decision. So if I want a CRM application for my enterprise, should I kind of develop it on my own, or should I go and just buy it, probably subscribe to force.com or to salesforce.com and start using it, right? So it's a make or buy decision, which means you don't have any development effort there, absolutely nil. Compared to a PaaS, PaaS provides you the runtime, which is the basic plumbing layers in place, which you can use to build your application, right? But you still have to build it, right? So there is some amount of development effort involved. And the IaaS is the bare minimum. So you get only the infrastructure, which means you devise your own architecture, your own platform, your own framework, and then you start building the functionality. So one aspect to think of is like how much of this you want to own, and how much of effort you are willing to put in, how much of control you want to retain back. So these are some of the parameters you can think of when it comes to the IaaS checking if IaaS is going to be suitable for me. The center boxes are the parameters itself, and the boxes on the left indicate or incline towards an answer of yes, which means SaaS IaaS is suitable for you. And the scenarios on the right side is something that inclines towards a no answer, right? So some of these parameters you might have already heard about, we just discussed now. But then the using all these parameters will help you to objectively decide if it is something that you would really be willing to move forward with an IaaS scenario, right? So as simple as, for example, the reuse of existing applications. So you might already have applications in place, so you have to reuse that, right? So you don't want to throw away all the applications and scrap it out. So from that perspective, IaaS probably makes sense. But then you will also have to see the other aspects like control of it, and then the SLAs that they have been providing, right? So those could help you make a decision of IaaS suitability. From a PaaS suitability, similar kind of things. Some key aspects, of course, the vendor lock-in itself comes into picture. Whether you are willing to live with the vendor that you are choosing to use, and is it okay with you from a policy perspective. And in some cases, there could also be new technology adoption that comes in, right? But more interestingly, the PaaS further gets divided into two broad categories. We usually people don't talk about it, which is called the IPaaS and the APaaS. The IPaaS stands for Infrastructure PaaS. It's somewhere in between the IaaS and the PaaS, you could say, right? So the IaaS is more, IPaaS is more inclining towards the infrastructure side of it, which means more of infrastructure support and less of the platform related services and things like that. APaaS on the other side is more towards the application building capabilities, right? As well as the infrastructure part of it. So Force.com, for example, fits in on the APaaS kind of a side. So it gives you, like we saw, enabling the citizen developers, it gives you the complete framework to be able to build applications quickly without any need of having the IT knowledge or the technical knowledge. You'll still be able to build applications. So that's one of the parameters. The technical skill set, if you don't have, APaaS becomes a much better choice for you, or if you think you have it. The other key things is the product complexity itself. Of course, APaaS, you can build applications, but not very complex applications. It has its own inherent limitations. So that's another aspect you need to think about. And of course, it's going to have some limitations. So you have to be sure if the vendor you're picking, the limitations that vendor has, is okay with you. And SaaS suitability, as I said, it's a typical make or buy decision. And some of the parameters are pretty self-explanatory, right? Varying usage patterns is one critical thing. So even though you could build the solution for various reasons, when the usage of it goes ups and down, then instead of you having the infrastructure or you going for a separate IaaS, it becomes much easier for you to just take it as from the SaaS provider, and he takes care of the entire load balancing of it and scale up of it. There is another aspect involved here, the multi-tenancy itself. And multi-tenancy, of course, for products makes a lot of sense, but for enterprises, not in all cases, but certain cases, it probably might make sense to have multi-tenancy, which means the solutions or applications you are building need to have the multi-tenancy in it. And some of the aspects could be the configuration capabilities that you might need, right? So if you want different kind of configurations, like different workflows, different business process, and each branch or each department within the organization might be requiring different configuration settings, then multi-tenancy is something that you might have to consider. And things like internal chargeback, where based on the usage, the appropriate branches or the departments will get billed back to it, which means you need to have the metering support and things like that. And also be able to share the resources. Very important, the multi-tenancy works under the concept of sharing, right? So your policy should be allowing you to share resources across these different entities. It could be the different branches or the different departments itself. But you should be okay to share the resources without any constraints. And there's another aspect to it also, which is the solution accelerator. Like we saw, the PaaS, the platform as a service, it provides you the complete application as well as the runtime of it, right? So you can completely design, develop, and deploy. But then what if you want to have the control of it, right? You want to determine certain aspects of it. Right? Solution accelerators come mostly to fill in that kind of a gap where it gives you a development framework, not a runtime. It gives you a development framework which can be used to build applications quickly But then once you build it, it's up to you to decide where you want to host it. So you can still go for an IaaS or your own private cloud or your own setup, right? So it kind of bridges in between the PaaS and your custom development, right? And the service characteristics itself is becoming one of the important aspects, because many customers, as I said, they have a question. I do also have a virtual server at my end, so I'm already using a cloud. But what really differentiates a normal data center or a normal virtual server versus a real cloud is these service characteristics. So the reason behind these service characteristics importance is this characteristics is what will determine the real benefit of going for a cloud, right? So the cloud has certain benefits which can be realized only when the service exhibits this particular characteristics. Now, this service characteristics are applicable to all the three dimensions we saw, which could be the deployment models itself, or it could be the application service models, the utility service models, right? So you take any of these service models, these characteristics are something that is expected at a bare minimum, which can probably help you provide a good cloud model, right? So more importantly, in terms of, for example, the metering aspect of it is one important need, where you will want to see in a transparent way what is the consumption being made till now, and how you can kind of go about plan your own the next set of usage and things like that, the scalability of it, and more importantly the online delivery. And interestingly, when we say online delivery, people always think it's just the web, and I have to use a browser to be able to use. So what if I don't have an access to a browser? So services can also be delivered using one of these things. It could be a thin client, a small native client sitting on your application, right? You can still use or provide such kind of services through these one of these clients. And just to give you an idea of the whole cloud consumption, how it can possibly be is, so as I said, those are different dimensions, right? So you need to look at your requirements and weave a net across all these dimensions, and the resultant of it is what is going to be your cloud consumption. So when you take your end users or the internal users, so of course they are going to have the business applications built by your own line of business developers, and once they are done with it, they could either deploy to an IaaS, which could be even be a private one, or they could decide to build it on a PaaS. So this is a scenario where you are using hybrid, right? Which means you are deploying or trying to use all the possible things. So which means that here you are responsible for managing it. So the IT staff here is responsible to manage this piece of it. Whereas here, you are not taking care of it because your PaaS provider is owning the responsibility, right? So the whole flow goes like this. So this kind of determines what is that you own, what is your level of ownership that is required, and what is that you don't have to kind of worry about, and is taken care by the vendors. So in a nutshell, the infrastructure and application management scenarios, one, is very important to understand which areas of it is something that will be of use, and areas that would really benefit you. Of course, the benefits of cloud is very evident in terms of cost optimization, in terms of the operational expenses and so on. But then, are these services really going to make sense for you? Do you have a lot of media content to be able to go for a storage as a service option, right? Where you can utilize the storage services and pay for what you are using, right? But if you don't have the very need of it, why even think of just cloud, right? So very importantly, that will help you determine the needs. The second one is the deployment models, which will help you make a strategic decision of whether I'm going to invest and have a private cloud in the first place, or I'm going to just go with a public cloud, or a mix of it, right? So that's a very important strategic decision, which will set the further roadmap for you as to how you can leverage the services you have identified here, then becomes the implementation of those services, right? But this decision will have an impact on how these services are going to be implemented. And the application and utility services will help you determine the kind of services that you can expect from the cloud vendor, right? So what is that I can expect out of these? I could probably need an IaaS along with a data as a service, or probably with a integration as a service, or billing as a service. So with these three combination, then I can go and look for vendors who are able to provide this. Maybe I can get a vendor who provides all of it, or I might have to probably pick a couple of vendors as a combination to be able to achieve that, right? And the service characteristics is something that will actually help you finalize the vendor itself, right? Because that's the differentiation they provide, and these are like bare minimum service characteristics. For example, availability and those things are implicitly understood, because all the models, all the services we saw, availability is important, right? SLAs are important, so those are common things. But other than that, the service characteristics will really tell you the quality of the vendor, and if those qualities are something that is up to the expectations that you have as an enterprise. So with that, I'll close this session and open for any questions.
Hi, you spoke about enabling citizen developers, right?
That's right.
Yeah, so I was just wondering, how is this different from what open source has on offer? Is this something proprietary, the framework that you provide, and why is there a difference in terminology?
Okay, when we say what a citizen developer can do is, in the earliest days you had what we call the RAD kind of tools, right? Like VB kind of tools, which gave you the visual development capabilities. You drag drop items, then you just hook up some code to it, you're done, your screen starts getting produced. So when we say APaaS is something even more at a higher abstraction. So you just probably put few boxes there, you want a grid of data, you drag and drop a grid, you link, this is the kind of information I want to see. So the user will need not even think to the DB design level at all. You need not worry about how the data is getting stored. Okay, I want this particular fields, I want it to be saved, I want a search capability, I should be able to see, I should be able to edit. So simple application, that's why I said complexity wise, you cannot build very complex applications. But many of the scenarios, if you look at, maybe 40-50% of the applications could be simple, straightforward applications. Though they don't require complexity. So you can even allow your citizen developers to build those applications instead of waiting for your IT team to be able to serve all of them.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you. And if possible, please fill in your feedback forms as well. That would be of great help. Thank you.
Yeah, I request you to fill up the feedback and hand it over to our guys there. And as usual, a small token of appreciation from the Cloud Connect team to Janaki from UBM India.